without further ado, I think I will hand you straight over to Ciarán Cooney, who has the usual meticulously prepared set of films, the product of a great deal of restoration work on his behalf. And I think there's some stuff we'll be seeing this evening that nobody's ever seen before, as far as we can work out. So over to you, Ciarán.
That's right. Thank you, Michael, for that introduction. And you're absolutely correct. There's two films that make up the bulk of this evening's presentations have never been shown ever before. So this is their first airing. One particular film, which is the first one, has been shown before, but like the previous Zoom presentations I've done on film shows, I'm bringing up everyone from Manchester, London, Dublin, up to date with all the material that I've shown, and effectively what I've been digitising and restoring from the society's film collection. So hopefully after tonight, everyone will be effectively nearly up to speed with everything I've shown. The running order for tonight is it's primarily the work of Joe St. Ledger. So we're going to begin with some scenes of the Mallow Waterford line taken within a couple of years, effectively, of the line's closure. So we're going to see a lot of interesting lifting trains, demolition trains operating in and around the Formoy area and Dungarvan, as well as developments that was happening at nearby Ballinacorty. Then we're going to move on to the late Tony Price's films, and these are going to be some of his early works that were shot in black and white. And I was only just saying to Michael at the start, just before we went live, that a lot of these early films of Tony Price's, he seldom showed them. Maybe he might have thought they weren't good enough, but I think they're excellent and fascinating. So we're going to actually see again Mallow Waterford scenes, but again, material has never been shown before, but these were taken more or less within the last year before the line closed in March 1967. Then we're going to move to the North Wexford line. So that's the line that ran between Waterford to MacMine Junction to Wexford via New Ross. And again, they're going to be demolition trains that Tony Price recorded in and around the mid-1960s. And then we're going to end with Tony's film on the Burma Road. So that's a goods train, pictures of goods trains effectively working up and down between Claremorris and Sligo. And then we'll probably break maybe for about 15 minutes, and then we'll have the second part of the show, which will be all again back to Joe St. Ledger's films, and this will be covering the Youghal branch. And again, it's made up of films from the 1960s and 70s, again never shown before, and there's so much stuff in it that I'll let the film do most of the talking. So that's Joe on the as you see him all set up with, I think, two still cameras, probably one with a slide camera and the other one with negative film, but you can also see the actual cine camera. Most of what you see in these films was shot on that very camera that you see on the tripod there. So Joe purchased his cine camera about 1968-69, and one of the first places he did start to record was actually on the Mallow Waterford line. Joe loved the permanent way work, but he rather poignantly photographed and recorded much of the demolition and lifting of these lines. And that's us. You see the bottom screen, that's my own 8mm projector. So effectively, I've gone through the majority of Joe's films and making up lists of locations, locomotive class, trains, anything, effectively dividing up his material into different sections by geographically and by date. You'll see the kind of films, these get the smaller types, 3-inch, 4-inch wheels, and then that's my projector that's running there. So that's effectively having to watch all these now as you see them projected onto a screen, and that's the kind of the classic view of looking at them. So there's my list that I used to compile. So you can see there I've magnesite goods workings, the locations, and this all helps me inform me of what the best films are to put these together. And then I proceed on to actual digitizing them, and you can see that's my 8mm Winnet digitizer, and it's scanning frame by frame, so one frame at a time. And then when the process is effectively complete, it combines all the frames together into a video file. You can see there that's the actual cine film making its way through the digitizer, and I have it hooked up to a television screen that enables me to get a good idea of what's on it and make sure that everything has been done correctly. The films then are imported into some editing software where I tidy up the footage. I remove any of the shakes and jumping of it. I also do exposure and color restoration. So you can see there Joe making his way down some permanent way near Clonmel. And you see, this makes a huge difference to the original quality of the film. So you can see there, I'm able to adjust the shadow area to brighten up the front of the train. Then once those films are restored, they go into an editor. And as you can see here, effectively, these are all the clips that are make up. This is actually the film that you're looking at right now in the editing software is actually tonight's film. And you can see all the individual frames that I've effectively digitized them from start to finish. And then I rearranged material into effectively a presentation, and hopefully it all comes together quite neatly. But you can get an idea of the amount of editing that's required. And then it goes to a second phase of restoration. You can see there with the color, and that you'll see that scene in particular. And then the films are boxed away. So that's the work that goes into doing these things. I enjoy it immensely, but we owe a huge debt of gratitude to Joe St. Ledger for having recorded so much of the Irish railway scene from the late 60s onwards on film. Of course, he was a well-established photographer as well, and many of his pictures have been published in the journal. And this opening shot is of Ballyduff. Line had closed in March 1967. Tomorrow will be 55 years since the Mallow Waterford line lost its passenger and goods services. So Ballyduff. That's Joe. And this is the demolition train, C218, taken near Clan Dulan. That was Clan Dulan was located between Fermoy and Lismore. It was a single platform station with just one good siding on the downside. That's Carrigabrick Castle, and this is just outside Fermoy town. And you can see here, Joe managed to get the sun shining on the viaduct, and he gets the same train, C218, making its way gingerly across the viaduct from Clan Dulan. So the sun came out just at the right time. That viaduct was famous for where the Blue Max film that was made around this period, 1968. That's the CIE diesel tank that was used to refill the engines and top them up on the lifting trains. And this is inside Fermoy Station. These were shot around January 1969. A bit more of a wintry, dull kind of day now. Different C-class, this time a black and orange liveried one. C221. And that's the castle in the background. Of course, this viaduct spanned the River Blackwater. A rather deserted looking Fermoy Station. That's the Mitchellstown Bay platform on the right-hand side that was used by branch trains to that town. They also use rail-mounted tractors, and this is shot just on the Lismore side of Fermoy. And this is what the old Dublin-Cork road, which passed beneath the railway, again on the east end of Fermoy Station. That's a tractor hauling a couple of panels across the road. The siding that you see here, the turnout, that was a single siding on the, again, on the Lismore side of the Dublin-Cork road. It formerly was the goods yard of the Fermoy and Lismore Railway, which opened in 1872, because at the time there were two separate stations either side of the road in Fermoy, the Great Southern and Western one, which would be on the left-hand side, and the Fermoy and Lismore one on the right-hand side. Of course, they're eventually connected up when the Great Southern and Western took over the Fermoy and Lismore Railway. But that siding was a remnant from that time when there used to be two separate stations in the town. Now, this bridge was considered to be fairly useful, and CIE decided that it would be better off to recover the bridge and take it to Platten outside Drogheda, where the cement works was being constructed. So the bridge has been prepared to be taken away by rail. The pencil there, that's from the Faber-Castell pencil factory, which used to exist opposite Fermoy Station. You can see they had their own advertisement on the bridge. I think the factory is long gone now. The next Great Southern and Western Railway carriage, I think, was being used as by the lifting gang. And here we see another lifting train, this time passing through Castletown Road. You can see the grass and weeds growing up between the rails. It's locomotive C212. The station building still survives here, including the goods shed, as well as the signal cabin. And this is the next station up, Ballyhooly, and you'll see more of the rail car on the left, ex-Great Northern rail car that was used by the contractors lifting the line. That's Kilcomer Viaduct, C212, and then its arrival back into Mallow with rails recovered from the lifting train. So Sulzer B108. Now, Sulzer B108 brought the Inchicore steam crane to Fermoy. That's the 35-ton one. And this crane then was used to effectively lift out that bridge across Dublin-Cork Road, which you'll see in a second. This was all being done on the 16th of April, 1969. As you can see, the view from the road, Morris Minor passing. They also use a road crane as well to assist. Now, I've speeded up the film because when you watch it in real time, it takes a long time. But I've speeded up the film to get an idea. And there's the man himself making a cameo. They said they actually dislodged part of the parapet when doing that particular job, but I don't see any evidence of it in these shots that Joe recorded. Yeah, the weather turned a bit miserable by the time they were lifting the bridge pieces onto the flat wagons. And we, according to Railfans News, B108 left at 7 o'clock that evening with the bridge pieces. And we're just going to briefly jump away from Munster up to Drogheda, where we're going to see that bridge effectively being installed. So this is in Drogheda Station. And again, we're using the Inch of Cork crane and the Athlone crane, 20-ton Athlone crane, B144. And this is propelling onto the Navan branch in Drogheda Station to head out to Platten. A45 was the A class. And this is actually where Platten Cement Factory is nowadays. The only thing that was really happening back in 1969 was putting in the bridge piece. It was used as an internal road inside the complex passed beneath the railway. I'm told, though, that the bridge itself was again replaced back in the 1990s. So this whole scene has completely changed. But back onto the old Mallow Waterford line, that's the McGurk's contractors, which I mentioned earlier. This is an updated view of Ballyhooly with the track lifted completely. The owners didn't waste time extending the station building. This is just outside from away, I think it is. Kilcomer Viaduct, and there we see ex-UTA Railcar 104 or ex-Great Northern Railcar F, dating from 1938, an articulated railcar, the power unit in the centre. And here it is, Joe captures it going over Kilcomer Viaduct near Castletown Roach. And this is Dungarvan Station, rather forlorn looking Dungarvan. And we have A7 arriving with train with empty open wagons. And it's going over that very wide level crossing that was located just on the, as the railway effectively crossed over a mini inlet in Dungarvan, which you see there now. And of course, that's part of the Greenway. So A7 is heading into Dungarvan Station with these open wagons to collect sleepers. That's the level crossing just outside Dungarvan Station. Arrive in. Now run around. And it left the wagons there, but it took away the 20-ton brake van. And across the road. By this stage, the actual level crossing gates had been removed, so it was a totally open crossing, effectively. We see A7, this time at Kilmacthomas, again with a materials train, and at Kilmeaden now. All shot around spring 1970. That's Kilmeaden Station, now home to the Waterford Shore Valley Railway. And this is the construction work that was taking place at Ballinacourt, on the Ballinacourty branch outside Dungarvan town. And that's Ballinacourty factory, the Quigley Magnesite factory under construction. And we see A7 again, bringing some materials again to the work site. Fantastic location with the backdrop of the Cumara Mountains. And we see A7's back in Dungarvan, and this time the wagons are laden with sleepers. And gingerly crosses the road. Now, Dungarvan footbridge. I showed, I think last year, a couple of shots of the footbridge actually being taken away on a flat wagon, but this was shot just before then, and this is actually the Limerick steam crane arriving into Dungarvan and frightening a motorist at the same time, I think, just crossing the road with a Sulzer locomotive. So that crane was brought in to remove the footbridge on Dungarvan station. And according to Joe's notes, the footbridge was supposedly reused somewhere in the Mullingar area, but I haven't quite found the exact location. So B112 running round in Dungarvan station with the Limerick steam crane. You see the crane then goes to work. By this stage, almost complete. I think the crew had gone up to Ballinacourty and back again. So that's the Sulzer, same Sulzer engine, but arriving back into Dungarvan. You have some redundant sleepers now being loaded up. This was taken on the day of the last ever train to enter Dungarvan station. 19th of June 1970. We see, I think it's B152 or 162 propelling across the road into the station. B153. And once the station was lifted, the next job now was to tackle the section from the station up to the wide level crossing. So this was entrusted onto another Sulzer locomotive, and you'll see it causes quite a bit of a stir as they try and go across the road and lift at the track at the same time. This was shot on the 7th of July 1970. 1970. Sulzer B109. So, about to cross the road. I think the motorists aren't just too sure whether to go or to wait, but you see some get impatient and they go around it. It's a bit of a tight squeeze, and you can see that the rail's been pulled up from behind, causing a bit of a traffic jam. And this is at Abbeyside, which is effectively just a housing estate on the eastern side of Dungarvan town. B104, and this is the long causeway near Cluny, again just east of Dungarvan town. And we see Barna Wee Gates, Sulzer B104. This was shot around November 1970. So at this stage, only the section from Balnacorty Junction to Abbeyside was still in situ. But by February 1971, the spur into Dungarvan was lifted completely. And there is no run-round loop on the spur at this stage, so it meant all trains had to either propel or run up to Balnacorty to run round. On this particular day, there is effectively a brand new A or re-engined A class working the lifting train. This was the 6th of December 1970. A48 or. That's at the run round loop outside Balnacorty, and Joe just managed to squeeze into the shot. And you can see he's running around the lifting train at Balnacorty before propelling back into the spur. And on the same morning, A9R arrives with a laden dolomite train from Bennett's Bridge. Back to the lifting train, just on the, effectively on the town side of the causeway at Dungarvan. So A48R was probably the nearest an AR class got to Dungarvan station anyway, or Dungarvan town. This is Duro and Stradbally taking out the loop. Effectively the block post here closed when passenger and goods services had ceased in 1967. Another re-engined A-class, A59R. The Balnacorty traffic, that had commenced in April 1970. It's an empty Dolomite train heading back to Bennett's Bridge. Now, this some scenes of the IRRS special that utilise SLNCR Railcar 2509, or Railcar B. So that was in Waterford, and they had come via the South Wexford line and head out to see the new branch line to Balnacorty. That was on the 29th of August 1970, and that's 2509 in Balnacorty factory itself. and at Kill Mac Thomas. And Waterford South Station. And back in Waterford. But back to Ballinacourty, and here we have Sulzer B105 arriving with the weed spraying train from Waterford. So even though the branch line was effectively brand new, it still got the weed spraying treatment. And I also showed some shots of the ceremony that was up for the factory opening, which used a special train organized on the 18th of September 1970, B192 and B186, with the Pfizer headboards. And that's the train heading across Ballyvoyle Viaduct. I showed some shots of that a couple of years ago in Ballinacourty itself. This is the viaduct at Kilmac Thomas with a laden magnesite train. So magnesite train heading for Ballinacourty. This is taken at Carroll's Cross. It's A9R, I think it is, yep. Yeah. Laden magnesite train heading from Ballinacourty, which is en route to Waterford and will work all the way to Tivoli in Cork. You can see it has oil tanks attached on the back. This is B203 working a permanent way train at Kilmac Thomas. And then seen at Waterford West heading towards Kilkenny. Again, a couple of shots taken at Ballyvoyle Viaduct. 2GM's cross with an empty Dolomite train heading towards Bennis Bridge. That's the viaduct between Duro Station and Ballyvoyle Viaduct. So I'm at a laden Dolomite train, again 2GMs. And that's followed by a combined magnesite and oil train, hauled by an A class. And back to Kilmac Thomas Viaduct. Dolomite train heading for Ballinacourty. This is Kilmac Thomas signal cabin, and you'll see this train, I think what it is, it's laden magnesite heading for Cork, but the magnesite wagons hadn't entered traffic at this particular point, so they're using Dolomite wagons, I think, with the tarpaulin over it, keeping it dry, I presume. And that's the last particular clip from this particular film of Joe's. So we end with this shot of Kilmac Thomas Viaduct with a magnesite and oil train. So thank you very much. I hope you enjoyed that film. And we're going to now see some shots again, Mallow Waterford initially, but taken before all those particular workings had started on Ballinacourty. So these are Tony Price's early films. Shot in around 1966, 1967. And we're going to open with this view, a rather nice shot of a 121 called Goods Train at Tallow Road. was the Mallow Waterford line was one of Tony Price's favourite lines to record, and he has several shots taken from the footplate, but his line side shots are equally as good. So B121 class in the original grey and yellow livery, as it was then. I think it's B122. Heading for Waterford with a goods train from Mallow. And this is entering Mallow, going across the old road that led into the town at the north end beside the station. The bridge still exists, but the embankment has been removed. So that's a Cork-bound train from Rosslare entering Mallow Station. And this is synchronised gate opening at Ballinamuck Gates, just west of Dungarvan, on the OR672 road, A-class goods train. And a shot at Carroll's Cross, which was located between Kilmacthomas and Kilmeaden. So a train from Waterford entering Carroll's Cross. And this is a Sulzerhald goods train crossing over the road from Kilmacthomas to Waterford. The bridge no longer exists. It was a very dangerous bridge and it was demolished about 2001. And across Kilmacthomas Viaduct. It does look like there's a big gap between the engine and the wagons, but a bogey flat wagon is between the Sulzer and the rest. You can see. No, it's four wheel flats actually. And this is just taken on the curve between Ballyvoyle and Clonee. Again, all this section is now part of the greenway between Waterford and Dungarvan. That's a Mallow-bound goods train. And we have this shot now at Capoquin with a 141 class GM heading across the Blackwater River. And the quayside there, that was used by the Blackwater River Paddle Steamer Service, which operated until about 1913, but the quayside alongside the bridge still existed back then. Disused for many years. And this is Ballyhooly, which we saw earlier. That's brand new B181 class, B186. It had entered traffic on 26th November 1966. So probably a month or so just before this shot was taken at Ballyhooly. And we saw back at Clan Dulan, which is where we opened with Joe's films of the lifting trains. Yeah, you see some of the Tony's films, there's a little bit of damage to them, but I still think they're worthwhile to digitise. Single 121 class, arriving from the Mallow direction. Nobody seems to get on or off. This is B 1:33 outside Dungarvan, going across the long causeway, and then we chase it in the car, and then we see it at Knock Gates near Clonee. And same train entering Kilmacthomas. And going across that road. Sorry. And shot near Carroll's Cross. And jump into colour with this shot at Kilmacthomas Station. Soldier B105 arriving from the Mallow direction with a goods bound for Waterford. View. Sundry vans, a cattle van, and the tank that you see there, the bitumen tank, that would have been collected from Dungarvan station, where there is the county council had a tar storage depot. This is the causeway again, outside Dungarvan, B121 class. I think heading towards Dungarvan with a Cork-bound train. And this is Ballyvoy Vida. It's a GM diesel hauling a UTA. What you can, I'll just rewind it back because there's a little bit of flickering interference there. But if you look carefully, there's a UTA carriage and some wagons, followed by two Great Northern, I think, bogey vans, P vans as they were called. So it might have been a pigeon special, I think. Now we move on to the North Wexford line. And again, back to demolition trains. These were all shot by Tony in around 1965, when the line between New Ross and MacMahon Junction was being lifted. Again, his early films are a little bit poor in quality, but again, they're almost certainly unique. So we see B141 class, the class leader, at Palace East, collecting some of the redundant materials before heading off towards MacMahon Junction. And this is Chapel, intermediate station between Palace East and MacMahon Junction. Because regular passenger and goods services over to North Wexford had ceased in 1963. This is on a different engine, B177. And departing Chapel, heading back towards Wexford. And this is a location called Sparrow's Land. It was located between Chapel and MacMine Junction, and there is a beat siding here, but it was used an awful lot during the lifting train period. A bit green sea class this time. Some of the crew on the open flat wagons, along with some redundant sleepers, and all recorded in and around Sparrow's Land. And so the wagons are propelled into the siding at Sparrow's Land. It served as a temporary terminus when the line was being constructed from 1870 until April 1873. C-233-2. And you'll get a good idea just how filthy these engines, the Crossley engines, made a C-class. Some apprehension there as to how fit the points were. You can see the C-class there with the streaks of oil down the body side and the rather very dirty roof. This time was an A class on the lifting train, and we have A36 pictured at Chapel Station. And the station building and platform still exist at Chapel. Of course, the station nowadays is a private residence. So much of the track was still in fairly good condition, even though regular services had ended a good couple of years beforehand. And approaching Sparrow's Land. The bridge, as you can see here, this bridge no longer exists. And in fact, the road has been realigned effectively across where the railway used to run. Much of the lifting on the North Wexford line was done by rail mounted tractors, and I think you'll see there's a tractor actually on the back of one of these flat wagons behind A36. Yeah. One with caterpillar tracks. And so we move on to the last film of Tony's that we're showing tonight. This was all shot between Cooney and Claremorris, effectively the Burma Road. And these are all shots of goods trains taken at just various locations along the route, including Swinford, Kiltimock, etc. This section, these opening sequences with the rather boggy landscape, I think this is recorded in the Kiltimock area. And was all shot in around the early 1970s. And the little hillocks, you don't really see that at all nowadays in the countryside. And entering Swinford with the bridge over the main street of the town. And this is south of Swinford, taken at Esker Gates. That's a Claremorris bound train. Because these goods trains worked all the way down to Limerick. At the north end of the Burma Road, and we see a Sligo bound passenger train with two GMs. It's going across the bridge that used to effectively go across the link line that connected with the Sligo, Leitrim and Northern Counties Railway. And we have a brief shot here at Carrowmore. This location was one where it had a semaphore signal with twin arms, which was a common feature at some of the gates on the Burma Road. This would be a Claremorris bound passenger train. I'm not exactly sure which type of train this is. I don't think it's a Knock Pilgrimage special, but it's a special of some sort anyway. Of course, regular passenger trains across the Claremorris Sligo section had ceased in 1963. And entering Swinford and passing through Kiltimock and exchanging staffs. South of Kiltimock. And that brings us to the end of part one. So I'm going to stop sharing, Michael. I'm going to hand it back to you. But I hope everyone enjoyed those first two films from Joe St. Ledger and Tony Price. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much indeed, Ciarán. And the restoration work, as I think everyone will attest to, is absolutely phenomenal. I suppose it sounds ridiculous, but I think the restorations are better than some of the original when I saw them projected years ago. So with that, back to you, Ciarán, and you can take us on more journeys with Joe.
Thanks, Michael. So The entire second part of tonight's film show is all going to be concentrated on Joe's, effectively his home territory, which is the Cork to Youghal line. And we're going to effectively see the line as it is from the period of summertime into winter and then back to summertime. Effectively, we'll be seeing the sugar beet trains and goods workings followed by summer excursions to the seaside at Youghal. So you'll see a transition in terms of the types of engines, the type of trains, the type of scenes that were being recorded, mainly from the late 1960s up to about the mid 1970s. And there's all sorts of material in it. We're going to have some more permanent way work with steam cranes in it as well. So you're going to see all effectively every conceivable train on the Youghal branch. I've had this film edited for some time now, but it's only tonight for the first time that I'm going to be able to show it. So I hope everyone will enjoy some of the shots that Joe recorded on the Youghal branch. And we open with this shot at Myrtle Hill, just on the east side of Cork City. That's a single 121 class heading for Youghal, and that's followed by a goods train, again a Youghal goods, from Cork. A view from the footbridge at Myrtle Hill sees A39 Ore with a combined magnesite and oil train from Tivoli, heading to, of course, the ultimate destination, which we saw earlier, was Balnacorty. And then the north side of the Red Tunnel in Cork, same train, A39 Ore, with its magnesite and oil tanks. Of course, that engine is preserved by the IRRS Traction Group in that very same livery, and it also exists now in model form. This location is called Summerhill Junction, where the original Cork and Youghal Railway used to diverge to its own terminus at Summerhill, and that's a passenger working from Cove. Now we have a summer excursion train in Cork Station, B185. And Joe travelled on this to Youghal. Of course, a lot of the excursion trains, they used some Edwardian era Great Southern and Western stock, as you can see. That train was followed this time by a single 121 class, again arriving into Youghal with an excursion from Cork. B134, that's the engine preserved by the Railway Preservation Society of Ireland, under restoration currently at Inchicore Works. Turned on the turntable to run around and backs onto his train. Looks like a fairly long train. I think I counted 10 bogey carriages plus two vans. That's Joe himself. No doubt he got a picture of that. Also in Youghal that day was an A class, A49 Ore. These were all shot around 1969, early 1970. You see, A49 is backing its train into the bay platform adjacent to the promenade at Youghal. And so B134 departs. Back at Myrtle Hill, this time a 141 class engine on an excursion train. You'll see that the trains were often just made up of the local formations, just two carriages and a van. basically just all coupled together and to form one long train. And we have A33 or driver and signalman exchanging staffs at Mogili. Just a shot of the fun fair at Youghal. And we see A33 or arriving into Youghal and running round. Just a glimpse of a CIE bus. And we have A39 or again, this time on a different day, leaving Youghal, heading back towards Cork. This is just outside Youghal. A33 or now heads back with its train. Now this is Tivoli, A58 or heading through, passing the old platforms at Tivoli station that had closed long ago in November 1931. The bridge you can see is being reconstructed in the background. That's the road, main road leading out of Cork City, heading in the Youghal direction. I think it's the N8 road. And this was shot on the 9th of May, or May 1969. Bridge was being renewed, and it involved a temporary level crossing which the road was effectively rerouted into Tivoli Port and then across the railway adjacent to Tivoli Station, which you see in the background. That was a 121 class heading back to Cork with an excursion again from Youghal. Joe just managed to capture some of the road traffic heading over the bridge, and here's Joe himself at the docks in Tivoli, where work is being undertaken on the oil siding for the Balna Corti trains. A2R heading for Cork with a train from Cove, and equivalent working heading for Cove. Now we have B144 arriving with a laden magnesite train from Balna Corti, and as you'll see, it will go into the siding using two lever ground frame, and then it will propel back into the unloading area inside Tivoli. So the guard operates the traffic lights across the road inside the docks, and B144 propels his train into the unloading area. And the oil tanks, the storage tanks, were still under construction at this time. The oil traffic hadn't yet commenced. I don't think it wasn't until May 1971 when the oil facilities at Tivoli came into operation. And so B144 heads back to Balna Corti with its empty train. Now staying at Tivoli, here's a double-headed Mark II trial train, again made up of the brand new air-conditioned stock, but still in undercoat livery. A cove-bound train. And that's followed by a goods train, a short goods train, made of just two vans and a brake van, heading for Youghal, maybe in an overload special, as they sometimes call it. This is followed by a short permanent way train, just flat wagons. You see loading sleepers at Tivoli, train is hauled by B172. And by this stage, the oil traffic was now commenced at Tivoli. And we see A19 ore passing with an empty magnesite train heading for Ballinacorty. That's followed by B172, this time empty. And that's followed by A16 ore with a laden B train from the Youghal branch. You can see by the colours in the background of the trees and shrubs, this was taken in and around autumn. And this is another beat working, B170, departing Middleton. This train had crossed an empty train heading for Youghal, which you can see in the background. Hauled by A35 ore. Some of the laden wagons being shunted at Middleton, with the empty ones brought up to the loading area. It's just basically used a stack of sleepers in which lorries could reverse up and dump their load. So A35 ore proceeds towards Youghal. This is Youghal station again during the beet season. This was shot around February 1972, and for seemingly they brought in this conveyor belt loader, which to be honest doesn't look like a great success because it seems to get jammed quite a bit, and you'll see the farmers or the lorry drivers sticking some pitchforks into the mechanism to get it working again. Called a high vol cleaner loader. Well, that's how it's described in railfans news, but I can't think it was a great success because the more simpler method of loading it directly from the lorry, that recommenced not long after this shot. There's Youghal, Joe pictured with A47 ore. You can see there's another view of that loader I was just mentioning. And you can see it's the capacity, it seems like too small a size. And certainly it's a slower way of loading the beet. It was manufactured by Armour, it was. That the A or M E or again, that's the details of this are described in the Railfans News magazine. So A16 or departs Youghal with a laden beat, and you can see also there's another A class in the background on the goods. That's the more conventional method. But they'd put one of these in also at Killa. You can see the name of the, as I described it, written on the side of the loader. And we have a B201 class this time on the goods, B227, arriving into Killa. The sundries vans, or H vans as they're called, I think that conveyed beef pulp. A shot up again, beef loading at Middleton. You see the wagons got a bit of a battering from the lorries occasionally when they hit into them. A38 or arriving with a goods train from Cork was passing the B train from Youghal. This is a little bit later now. As you can see, the A class is in the CIE super train livery. We also have a 20-foot container. So this is a combined beat/goods working. A shot just outside Youghal town. And passing through Carrick Tool. You have to be careful, you might get struck in the head by some beat falling from the wagons, as you can see. And joining the main line at Bloontown or Cove Junction, 038. This is Middleton, summer 1971. The quarry at Liz Duff was closed during the summer months. So for permanent way ballast trains, they received it from a local quarry in Middleton, Ellis Quarry, owned by the Ellis family, I think it is. And we see Sulzer B106 at Cove Junction, having been loaded in Middleton with stone from the quarry. And the section of line that was receiving attention was in the North Esk area. This was taken before work had commenced on the North Esk container terminal. So that's effectively where North Esk, the entrance to North Esk, would be nowadays. That's a Youghal goods hauled by a 121 class. And you can see B106 dropping ballast. So that's North Esk level crossing. That's long since being closed. So the gatekeeper's house still exists. And this is B106 passing through the old station at Dunkettle, which is where Joe St. Ledger actually grew up, in the station house. So the sidings to North Esk, as you can see, are just, work has just commenced on putting in the points into the yard. That's a local train from Cove. You can see there's the points. And work is now a bit more advanced with the turnout at the Cork end. This was shot in around 1974. B train from Youghal. and another B train, this time all by an A class. Of course, the sidings and the gantry crane, it was still some time before that all came into North Esk. And this is the old bridge that led into the entrance to the container terminal. And you'll see it getting replaced. This time a permanent way train. I think it's bringing in the Athlone crane, maybe, or the Grand Canal Street crane, as you can see written on it. So that was based in Grand Canal Street in Dublin. So you can see the train is hauled in by re-engine 201 class 217. It's about to take out the bridge section. I think it became a necessity to replace the bridge because the road was widened and it needed a much stronger structure to accommodate all the freight lorries that were arriving into the yard. Here we see the train arriving into Cove Junction with the bridge sections on the flat wagons. And shunted back into the siding at the Cork end of the station. In this shot, you can see that the bridge is gone completely. There's a temporary level crossing in its place. Just some unusual shots here now of tree felling on the Cove line, arriving into Rushbrook, Cove-bound train. This is taken near Little Island, around 1974. Those are B103, with sleeper train. Of course, this engine was the sole surviving Sulzer locomotive preserved by the Irish Traction Group. I'm passing through Little Island Station. Much of the work had already been completed, as you can see by the fresh ballast, and this particular train was collecting redundant sleepers that had been taken out. Cove train hauled by a B201 class. And that's followed by a goods train. Again, Youghal. You'll see the open wagons with the tarpaulin. I think they may have been laden with fertilizer from Gouldings in Cork. Shot in around, I think, September 1972, these scenes were recorded. That's Dunkettle Station in the background, and that's a goods train from Youghal. And as you can see, the water just in the foreground, just alongside the estuary in Cork, all that has been filled in since. And we see Youghal station and an empty B train arriving from the Cork direction. This time it's hauled by an A-class, unre-engined A50, one of the A-classes to receive a yellow warning panel to its front. And also in Youghal this particular day was a Sulzer locomotive on the goods working. B-102. This was taken around early 1970 or late 1969. The much quicker way of loading beet than rather using the conveyor belt method. Now, during this period, the seafront or promenade at Youghal was undergoing major reconstruction. And this train, I don't know what exact train this is. You see, there's a flag maybe at the end of it or something. It might have been, if anyone from Cork might know the answer to this, why a particular train with two carriages and a van and a sundries van had worked to Youghal. I don't know whether it was something to do with the contractors carrying out the work on the promenade. Was it a workman's train or was it bringing in extra equipment? I'm not too sure. But here we see B124 bringing in the goods from Youghal, and you'll see again, there's the carriage with the four-wheel van and the sundries van attached to it. I haven't established why that worked to Youghal. I think the four-wheel van, I think, is like an ex-TPO van. Okay, so this is just a quick post-edit to the film show. Thanks to an audience member who kindly got in touch following the show, we now have an answer for that unusual train that Joe recorded, Stables and Youghal. It was, in fact, a train that travelled the country to promote and demonstrate products made by the Gestetner Printing Company, and which was formed of standard carriage 1500, four-wheel TPO 2970, and sundries van 18731. In this sundries van was a generator plant that was used to supply power to the carriages. The train began its tour on the 27th of January 1971 and visited 37 locations in Ireland as well as Northern Ireland. You can find further information about the train in IRRS Journal 55, June 1971. So thanks again to that member. We've managed to solve that mystery. So back to the show. And this is a light engine captured at Killa, heading to Youghal. I think it's B164. Now, the bridge at Killa was being replaced in around February 1971. It had a severe weight restriction on it, and you can see this rather heavy road crane going over. Can't have helped it much, but the bridge, you can see, is some proprietary works had already been undertaken on it. As you can see, the parapets have been removed. And we have the goods train from Cork arriving into Killa behind B124. C-class bus, I think that they were called. B124, having dropped the goods, I think in Youghal, comes to collect some wagons out of the siding in Killa and proceeds back to Cork. And that's the Inchicore steam crane at Cove Junction with the new bridge pieces for Killa. And we're told on Sunday, the 21st of February 1971, B106 hauled the crane and Killa from Dublin to Cove Junction and then worked the following morning to Middleton. The crane itself worked to Killa, and that was preceded by the Sulzer locomotive with the bridge pieces. And here we see the work being undertaken at Killa. Joe was great at capturing all this activity, and particularly the permanent waymen at work. Sections are lifted into place. I think the man with the triple E hat was likely to be a permanent way inspector. And there's Joe himself getting amongst the action. Yeah, it's a bit Alfred Hitchcock-esque, isn't it? And as usual, two cameras. Of course, while all this was going on, the regular workings were continuing. So we see B124 with its goods train from Youghal. And then I think this is later in the day, arriving back from Cork. And we move in back into the summertime, which is when we effectively started off with the summer excursion trains. So this is a little bit later. These scenes were all recorded in around 1973 to about 1975. That's Cove Junction or Gloontown, and we have a train heading for Youghal. It's just branched off the main line. This is just outside Youghal, or nearer to Bog Road, where the distance signal, I think, was for Youghal. Again, a long summer excursion train from Cork. The bridge you see in the background, that's where the previous shot was taken. It's a 045, I think it is, arriving into Youghal station. You see, by this stage, the old Edwardian stock had been phased out. We just have the usual Cravens and laminate carriages, as well as some Park Royal stock. But in addition to that, in a complete contrast to the Great Southern and Western Railway stock, we have the brand new Mark II carriages, air-conditioned stock, seen arriving into Youghal from Cork. All by A50 Ore. So that's followed by 045, Departing. Looks like people have been enjoying their time at the beach and are heading now back home. In a return excursion passing through Mogili, all by 031. Someone just making a quick jump on board. And then the guard jumps out, I think, and waves the train away. And then another excursion train with the Mark II stock called by A13R, and you'll see he's actually going into the bay platform adjacent to the promenade in Youghal. So it just shows you where these Mark II carriages managed to get to. So there it is in the bay platform. There was another platform or another track on the right hand side, but that had been removed. Now, we saw A39 earlier, and now we have it as O39, and it had suffered some sort of mishap in Youghal station on this particular day, coming off the rails, and you'll see the efforts to try and re-rail it, but no doubt, I think it caused a bit of a mess, because capacity was already a bit tight in Youghal station for all these excursion workings, and I think he's effectively blocking the run-round loop. See there, he's off the rails a little bit. They seem to be using blocks of wood to try and get it back on again, and they are eventually successful. Most of these summer excursion trains, they effectively ceased by the late 1970s, and that just left a few GAA or pilgrimage specials reaching Youghal in around mid and early 1980s. I think the very last working to reach Youghal was about 1988. That was a permanent way train. So we see 041 arriving into Middleton Station. This is at Cove Junction. Maybe someone can identify, I think, the six signal man or station staff on duty. You see a train arriving from the Youghal direction and joining the main line behind 041, or the driver about to exchange the staff, one of the long staffs. And the final few sequences of tonight's presentation will feature some more permanent way workings, this time in around 1973-74. By this stage, the ballast wagons had been upgraded to the newer versions that we can see here, and these were only withdrawn about 10 years ago. This time it's the soles are hauled, B110, in the attractive black and tan livery. It's propelling, running round using the yaw branch at Cove Junction. And that's just light engine passing through Dunkettle. Presumably the crew are heading back to Cork. And then another shot of it at Cove Junction, and then passing through Carrigtootle, heading empty to Middleton. And as I mentioned earlier, when Liz Duff was closed, they tended to load ballast in Middleton Station. Now joining the main line, this time laden. That's Ellis, as I mentioned, the quarry owners. That's one of their lorries. And in this particular shot, this is back to 1971, I think it is, because it's using the old ballast wagons, which date from the pre 1925 wagons from the Great Southern and Western Railway stock. That's the yaw bound goods again at Middleton Station. And then maybe again someone local to the area in Gloonton might be able to identify who those two people might be, and the dog maybe as well. And so we have the laden ballast train again joining the main line at Cove Junction behind B156. And you can see it's made up of the old Great Southern and Western and Midland Great Western ballast wagons. I think there might even be a few Great Northern wagons in that formation as well. You see the van on the back has a plow underneath the frame, or ploughing the ballast as it's laid along between the sleepers. This is level crossing at Myrtle Hill. Still exists today, although it's controlled automatically. And that's where some of the ballast was being dropped, at Summerhill Junction. So I think the cutting that you see in the background, that used to lead to the original terminus at Summerhill on the Cork and Youghal Railway. Here's the train passing through again Dunkettle Station. No doubt returning to get loaded again at Middleton. Just a couple of clips of a bus. That's a fairly new Atlantean bus, I think, as they call it. And then a C-class bus. And this is in Kent Station in Cork, Soldier B112. Because shunting the Grand Canal Street crane. That's one of the old camping carriages. A Wickham inspection car. Bread vans, I think they used to be called or nicknamed. And this is some permanent way work being undertaken in Kent Station in Cork. A33 or looking fairly fresh, so it's probably just re-entered service with its brand new GM engine having been re-engined, having gotten rid of its Crossley engine. And we have A53 or on a similar ballast working to that of B156. again, picture that, Myrtle Hill, and you can see the crew dropping the ballast along the track. And passing through Tivoli, the old station at Tivoli, you can just about make out the platforms. In the very last sequence, we have a passenger train heading for Youghal, passing through again Dunkettle Station, which appropriately was where the St. Ledger family were based, and it's where, of course, Joe grew up. So that scene brings a close to tonight's presentation. So I hope you all enjoyed those shots of Joe's. And again, we owe great gratitude to Joe for traveling the length and breadth of the country, recording all those wonderful scenes, which almost certainly are unique. I can't think of any person who went to such great lengths to record, particularly the permanent way workings. And again, I have to thank the St. Ledger family for the donation of Joe's films to the society, which has given me great pleasure in editing down and presenting here on so many occasions tonight. So I'll hand you back to you, Michael, and thank you very much.
Thank you very much indeed, Ciarán. We don't have facilities for applause, but I'm sure there will be plenty of silent applause out there for the work you've done on the restoration, which is absolutely outstanding. I think we're getting professional level restoration with attention to detail and skill that is quite astonishing. So really very, very well done indeed. And also for the editing and the selection, because it was something Tony Price was always very keen on. It was the editing. He said it's easy enough to take the pictures, but to thread them together into something coherent is a separate skill altogether. And I think Tony, if he were with us, would be very proud and pleased to see his material given such a wonderful showing tonight as well.